Can everyone please take your seats? Okay, it's my honor once again to introduce Dr. Burt Folsom. Dr. Folsom is the longest serving faculty member of Young America's Foundation student programs, where he consistently receives top ratings from the young people he reaches at each CHEAF event. Over the last four decades, Dr. Folsom has taught U.S. history at Murray State University, Northwood University, and Hillsdale College. He was the Charles Klein Professor of History at Hillsdale College from 2003 to 2017, and he was recently appointed Distinguished Fellow at Hillsdale College. Dr. Folsom has written several books. His book, Myth of the Robber Barons, is now in its seventh edition and is published by Young America's Foundation. His other books include New Deal or Raw Deal, FDR Goes to War, co-authored with his wife, and Uncle Sam Can't Count. Please join me in re-welcoming Dr. Burt Folsom.
Hey! Thank you. Many of the greatest achievements in American history occurred when a black person and a white person put their minds together, and the creative result was a magnificent leap in American history. Let me reword that a minute. The catalyst for major change, the impetus for progress, has often occurred in American history when a black person and a white person put their minds together, worked on a problem, and the results were magnificent. Is that a thesis you're hearing today developed in the schools and media? There are many sides to the race issue, aren't there? And some of them are very unpleasant. But I think we need some balance. Let's just start here for a minute with Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C. was laid out 10 square miles in the area where we are in, near. And those 10 square miles are the starting point for American history as we know it, U.S. history. The designers, the two people who worked through picking the property, working it all out, Andrew Ellicott, a white, and Benjamin Banneker, black. Those two people in Washington, with Washington's, in George Washington's incredible approval, he wanted Banneker. And Banneker had a tremendous relationship with Thomas Jefferson. They wrote back and forth. Banneker was a great scientist. Ellicott was an expert surveyor. The two of them put their minds together and designed the capital of the United States, the land that would constitute the capital of the United States. Look, let me do to one more modern, at least within the lifespan of people who are alive today, not people in this room, but people who are alive today. One of the big bursts of energy in sports is a mode of entertainment, was when Jackie Robinson, you have the Negro Leagues and then the Major Leagues, which are white. They're separate. Jackie Robinson was the breakthrough player, as you know, in 1947, that came in, became Rookie of the Year, the black player that integrated Major League Baseball. Who is the general manager of the Dodgers? Does anybody know? Okay. Branch Rickey. Branch Rickey was the catalyst behind a lot of that. Studying, he wanted to integrate. He believed that America would be a better nation, that entertainment would be better, that sports would be better, that as a humans, we would be better if we integrated Major League Baseball. And he picked Jackie Robinson. He sent him up for a year in the minor leagues in Montreal in 46. It was after World War II. And the argument is this: black and white, we're working together in the armed forces. This nation ought to be integrated. Sports. The war's over in 45. In 46, Jackie Robinson is in the minor leagues. And in 47, Branch Rickey brought him up. And Branch Rickey, with the two of those two would sit down and talk and work. And Rickey would say, Rickey had been a general, of course, the Dodgers were back in Brooklyn. It's the Brooklyn Dodgers. But he'd been general manager of the St. Louis Cardinals when they were really a powerhouse in the 30s. He said, I've been in Major League Baseball for a long time. Here are the problems that you're likely to confront, and would address him right there. And the two of them would work it back and forth, how to handle problems. No, it wasn't a perfect transition, but it was a very good transition. And when the Brooklyn Dodgers, in their united form, black and white, working together, you could see them as a team unite behind that concept, and you could see fans, blacks and whites, coming together, uniting behind a team. Cleveland entered in the American League, integrated next, and then in 1948 they won the pennant in the World Series with the black and white team. The city celebrated. Teammates celebrated, hugging one another, a new dimension in the advancement of race relations took place because a black person and a white person sat down and worked through a problem. Now you get people, and we've had a difficult times too with race relations sometimes in our history, and that's where the emphasis has been, to the exclusion of all this other. A lot of it revolves around slavery. Let's talk about slavery for a little bit. The same principle holds true in slavery. The institution of slavery has existed from the beginning of time. We can just go back to ancient Sumer, the oldest civilization we know about, and their slave transactions. It was uncontested in history, other than you didn't want to be the slave. But I mean, as a system, it was uncontested in society after society. The Romans and the Greeks, absolutely. All through, and then you get in, and thus in the United States. The United States, we're going to have slavery. It's going to be profitable for a while. It's profitable. It's going. And then all of a sudden, you have black and white coming together. And when that happened, that was going to be the end of the institution of slavery in the United States. And it happened with the Underground Railroad. What is the Underground Railroad? Yes, Charles? Speak up here.
Wasn't it like a network of people helping slaves run away from wherever they were, not really working, but more like slaving at.
Yeah, right. It was. It was a network. It's going to be black and white. You have the slaves, black, and then you're going to have a network. Now, they're going to be leaving the plantation and their owners running away. The penalty there is huge. I mean, death. Possibly, but if not, beatings that are huge, but very possibly death. But you have white people who are going to be involved, and they're going to be people stationed all throughout the South, moving in a northerly direction. And it's secret where each of the white people knows where the other one is. They know where they are up the line so that they can give advice to the runaways as they move north into free territory in Pennsylvania. And yes, the whites are taking a risk because anytime you aid and abet a fugitive, you are taking stolen property. And you're going to be liable financially. It won't be a death penalty, so it's not like the runaway slave, but it is still a financial penalty and prison possibly if you are caught doing this. Slavery is an accepted in human society, and it's going to be challenged here in the United States when black and white work together on the Underground Railroad. Who can identify Harriet Tubman? A lot of you. Good. Who's Harriet Tubman?
She was someone who was famous for working with
me. Right. Someone who's famous for working with the Underground Railroad. Yes. We're going to tell more about her because she was a special person working on the Underground Railroad, because she's going to go back and forth on the Underground Railroad. Who is anybody, can anybody identify for me Thomas Garrett? Yeah. A lot knew Tubman. See, that's interesting because those two names were synonymous. And one is remembered and one isn't. But both wanted to be remembered together because they both had incredible opinions of one another. Thomas Garrett is the last stop on the Underground Railroad, a white guy, in Wilmington, Delaware, right before you get into Philadelphia. He is the last stop on the Underground Railroad. I want to talk a little bit more of this. Harriet Tubman is born in Maryland. She's born about 90 miles or so south of freedom. Slavery is a terrible institution. I think we need to get both sides of this in there. Harriet Tubman, at least she was allowed to live with her family. Her family, the Ross family, her maiden name was Ross, Harriet Ross. And she had brothers and sisters, mother and father were on the plantation. She was allowed to marry, even, a man named John Tubman, which is, of course, where we get Harriet Tubman. John was a free black, and they were allowed to live together. And so they at least had that going for them. But listen, she had a tough life. She was 5 feet tall, but she had the incredible gift of speed. I mean, she's, you know, just incredible Olympic runner style. And she had something to go with it that was also good that she didn't know was an advantage when she was growing up. She had incredible eyesight at night. She could see in the dark incredibly well. And she had courage. And so what happened is Harriet's working, but listen, she had a huge scar on her face because the master of the plantation had thrown an iron object. He wasn't aiming for her. He was aiming for somebody else. It inadvertently hit Harriet and put a gash all the way across her face. There's no recourse because slaves don't have rights. And so it's a terrible situation. And anyway, anytime you're denied freedom, America is founded on freedom. Freedom is in many ways in our DNA. And you're denied freedom, that's a bad thing. The Declaration of Independence, all men are created equal, and men making a general reference to men and women. All men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. That among these are what? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That is going to be a problem with slavery, and much of America's early history is going to be trying to resolve that. And it's going to be resolved when black and white work together. Harriet Tubman, working on the plantation, was very concerned because the plantation agriculture has its ups and downs, and when it has its downs, it's people had to be sold off. There were threats. She was going to get family members, she heard, possibly sold off. This bothered her. He talked with her husband, John, who was a free black. I mean, he could technically go any time. But she said, John, maybe we ought to get out of here and we ought to try to make a run for it. I mean, John, after all, is a free black. He could have gone up north and found something and maybe helped get her up out there somehow, even without the Underground Railroad. But he wasn't interested. No. We're doing just fine here. I want to stay here. When she became, about the time she was becoming convinced that it could be in the next week or month that she might get sold or her parents might get sold, about that time, she had a white woman who came and visited the plantation. And I want to quote this properly. Ann Petrie's book on Harriet Tubman entitled Harriet Tubman is my source for this. And she says that the woman said, another one, she comes in with a wagon, she sees Harriet, and she says to her, Harriet, if you ever need any help, ever need any help, why, you let me know. I mean, what kind of, you know, that's a weird. She came back and, to John. John, what did she mean by that? I don't know. Don't pay any attention to it. Harriet, as the time when the sale might occur became at hand, she said, John, I'm going to have to go to her house at night. And I'm just going to find out what she means by that. Harriet left without her husband's approval, really. Went over to that man, the woman's house. She had told her where she lived. And she knocked on the door at about midnight. And the woman, she says, when she opened the door, it's like she was expecting me. I did not know it, Harriet said at the time. I was at the first stop on the Underground Railroad. This woman was part of the network of white people willing to take a chance to help black people get the freedom which God gave them, because it's God-given natural rights. She told Harriet where the next stop was. See, you always knew where the next stop, if you're the white person, you had to know where the next stop is to move north. And she said, go up the road. She described it. She says, we'll send you out at night. Stay here tonight. We'll send you out at night. And she gave Harriet directions, and Harriet went to the next stop. She had to travel at night, where the night vision is so helpful. And then she has, because she can't be on the road either. She has to be kind of off the road a lot of the time. She made her way up, was taken in, and then that person showed the next stop. Well, Harriet, it was kind of rough doing all this thing, and she was barefoot. I mean, that's even rough. And you're going in the briars out there off the road. And so Harriet was always told, when you get to see Thomas Garrett, he always gives you a pair of shoes. That's what I hear. And she thought, well, you know, I'm going to keep going north, and maybe I'll meet this Thomas Garrett. She finally got to the stop at Wilmington, which is the last stop before Philadelphia. And she got to Thomas Garrett, and he was a Quaker. Very much influenced. And Harriet was a strong Christian. And Harriet later argued it's the Christianity that undercuts a lot of this system of slavery, because Thomas Garrett and Harriet both liked these scriptures. In Galatians, the book of Galatians in the Bible, chapter 3, 28, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither male nor female, there is neither slave nor free, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Powerful. Later in the chapter 5 in Galatians, verse 1, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free. Do not be entangled again with a yoke of slavery. Garrett, being a Quaker, he spoke in thee and thou. That's the way Quakers did back then. Harriet Tubman said, well, I'm not going to thee and thou it, but I am going to Bible it with you. And so the two of them, they actually got along famously. She discovered that he had a hidden room. You know, it's like one of these, you open the bookcase, and he says, when the authorities come in, I just have my fugitives hide here. And he fed her. She says she got the best meal from Thomas Garrett, and he had a pair of shoes for her. And he always said, I'm the last stop. And he says, if necessary, I will drive you in my own carriage to freedom, where William Still, a black man in Philadelphia, who owns a business in Philadelphia and can help get jobs and get people located in different places where it's safe for them, he'll be the one to help you. But he says, it's better in a way for me not to drive you if I can't help it, because sometimes the authorities are looking for me. They're always after me. Well, he told Harriet the route by which she might make it to Philadelphia, and she did. She was free. She had her freedom. But that was insufficient for Harriet. She wanted her family. She wanted her family. I want to come back and get them. It's unprecedented, the courage she had. And she said, well, I know where the first stop is, right? Going the other way. She showed up. Thomas Garrett's just, Harriet, I did not expect to see thee again. And she's there. He says, I'm going back for my family. And he gave her all sorts of encouragement, like a pep talk. Wow, if you're going to do this, I'm all for you. And he gave her food. He says, you still have your pair of shoes. He says, everybody you bring up there, I'll have a pair of shoes for them. And she went back down. When she went down, she wanted to get her husband. She thought, he'll be so excited. And to see what's happened to me, that I'm free, that we can come up, and he's already free. We can just go right back up. She came in. I want to quote Ann Petrie again in her biography of Harriet Tubman. She came in, she opens her door, knocks on it, and opens the door of their little cabin. She saw her husband, says, John, I came back for you, John. Me, he said. The door opens wider, and there's another woman. This is Caroline, he said. Caroline is my wife now. I'm not going north or anywhere else. I wouldn't leave here for nothing in the world. Harriet was just utterly shocked, and she said, when the door was slammed in my face, the one thing I knew was, this thing isn't over with the door being slammed in my face. He says, I saw the look on Caroline's face, and Caroline's going to go to the master. Edward Brodus is the master, the name of the Brodus plantation. He says, I'm in trouble. She rounded up, was able to get a brother. She was able to see her parents who didn't want to go at that time, but she was able to get to, and was able to get two family members out, move them up on the Underground Railroad into freedom. She kept telling the brother, you know, the brother kept kind of trying to wimp out, you get moving it up here. Thomas Garrett's going to give you a pair of shoes. Now get moving. And they got there, and sure enough, Thomas Garrett had a pair of shoes for him, for both of them, and they went north. Harriet goes back for other family members. And when she went back for family members, she, after that, went back for others. Harriet was going to be a famous on the Underground Railroad, working black and white, working together to promote the ideas in the Declaration of Independence. Working together. Well, some of the dramatic episodes that Harriet Tubman and Thomas Garrett had together are something. For example, let me kind of illustrate this. I've got, they had a bridge which you get into Wilmington. We'll say this is Pennsylvania right here, PA. Wilmington's right here. There's a bridge. I'll do it in a large bridge. There's a bridge coming over the city to get into Wilmington River. There's a river running in here, and you've got a bridge. Okay. Now, the problem is the river here underneath, and you've got the bridge from one side to the other. Harriet Tubman was so widely known in Garrett that the police were all over the bridge when she had another group that was coming in. The word had gotten out. Some people had detected them, and they said, Tubman may be back. They have the bridge. And so Harriet has to get, you have policemen all over the bridge, and Garrett is up here. Okay. So the question is, how do we get to Garrett? So there were free blacks in the area, and she put all of the escaped slaves with free blacks that were in the area, got a message to Thomas Garrett over the, because they were looking, if someone was just a white person walking through, or even a black person, you're not going to just frisk them and serve anything. She had a message, dropped it off to Garrett, and so he understood the situation. Here was Garrett's solution. The Wilmington Bridge, I'm reading from Earl Conrad's book, Biography of Harriet Tubman. The Wilmington Bridge, which the fugitive slaves must cross, was heavily guarded by police. But in spite of the heavy guard, Harriet was able, by means of scattering her group, to place them in various black homes in the vicinity. For the purpose of crossing the bridge, she communicated with her regular standby, Thomas Garrett. As soon as Garrett learned of the plight of the slaves, he evolved this plan to aid them. He engaged two wagons and filled them with bricklayers. He sent them across the bridge as if they were on a party, singing and shouting. Bricklayers going to build a house. So they're crossing here in the morning, making a big scene, singing and shouting. The police see them. The guards saw them pass and, of course, expected them to recross the bridge later. After nightfall, the wagons returned, but this time, no bricks, concealing the fugitives instead. The slaves were on the bottom of each of the wagons, and the bricklayers still sang and shouted and diverted attention as the fugitives entered the gates of Wilmington. And they just happened to have a stop by Thomas Garrett's house, who just happened to have a carriage to drop them all off to William Still. And so a week later, the police are diligently guarding the bridge, and all of the fugitives had made it to safety. Black and white working together to promote the ideals of the Declaration of Independence. Now, one time when Harriet was making her trips, she had helped former slave named Thomas Otwell escaped. Thomas Otwell was in Pennsylvania, and he noticed something interesting, and that is that there was a reward for Harriet Tubman. He was fascinated with that. Gee, if I could turn her in, I could get some good cash out of this. He told Harriet he wanted to go back and help her on the Underground Railroad. Unsuspecting, Thomas Garrett saw Otwell and Harriet, and they come back. Harriet rounds up some people, some fugitives who are willing to take the chance. And by the way, Harriet didn't play games with people on this thing. She had a gun. Some of you may have heard. I mean, she'd say, I don't like it anymore. I'm going to go back. No, you're not. The gun. She said, I never had to use the gun, but I threatened it on occasion. Well, the fugitives are coming up. Harriet decides, well, Otwell can handle things, he knows, and she departs. Well, that's good news for Harriet. But he can still turn their eight of them in. And he has an arrangement with a white guy in Dover, Delaware, right before Wilmington. It goes Dover, Wilmington, freedom. So you have to catch him before you get to Garrett, obviously. So you have the Dover is where you're going to catch, where you're going to stop him. You tell him about Garrett. Oh, don't worry, keep going. Garrett will be there. And so you've got the stop right before. And he said, stay here. And he put him inside what turned out to be a jail and locked it. Apparently, one of the eight fugitives was, hugely strong. I mean, like Shaquille O'Neal or LeBron James or somebody tore the thing open, and they all just ran out. And before the authorities could get them, they had jumped to freedom. Six of them, they'd heard so much about Garrett, they were able to stop and encounter some free blacks who helped them, told them where Garrett was, and six of the eight made it to Garrett. Two of the eight were not really sure what happened, but some of them made it to freedom. Thomas Garrett was absolutely frantic. He said, because he didn't know if Harriet had been caught or not. He wrote Benjamin Still, the guy in Philadelphia, his contact there. He says, I've been very anxious for some time to hear what has become of Harriet Tubman. Has thee seen or heard anything of her lately? It would be a sorrowful fact if such a hero as she should be lost from the Underground Railroad. Wow. He had helped 2,700 slaves get their former slaves, get their freedom. But in his mind, Harriet Tubman was the hero. He just thought so much. He was so glad to always see Harriet Tubman. She was so glad. She says, oh, I got this group in here telling them how good it was going to be to see you. He says, thee has done a good thing, Harriet. Here's the food. And it would be this buffet for the people coming in. I regret to say this, but Thomas Garrett, when you do this with 2,700 people for a long time, he was caught. He got caught and was fined. See, we caught him with these slaves. They're worth this much. Your property is going to be sold. It was sold. His store was sold. Everything he had was sold. He's sitting there with nothing. Chief Justice Taney of the U.S. Supreme Court presided over the trial to nail this guy. Black and white working together had some things to overcome. I'm reading here from Ann Petrie's book again. She says, the fines and damages that Garrett had to pay took every dollar of his property. His household effects and his belongings were sold at public auction. The sheriff who conducted the sale turned to Garrett, the sheriff in charge of the sale of all his stuff. Thomas, I hope you'll never be caught at this again. Garrett, who was 60 years old, answered, friend, I haven't a dollar in the world. But if thee knows a fugitive anywhere on the face of the earth who needs a breakfast, send him to me. He was committed. It was going to be black and white working together to undermine slavery, because all of the people, Frederick Douglass was had escaped north and had a newspaper. All of these people who were escaped were sending messages, slavery is terrible. Don't let anybody tell you, oh, it's just fine for those who are slaves. It's immoral. It's against everything that we stand for in the U.S. Constitution. Loud outcries as Harriet continued to get more escaped slaves off through the Underground Railroad into freedom. If you look at this accomplishment, the Underground Railroad was a major contributor to undermining the system of slavery, to showing the weakness in the system of slavery. And the escaped enslaved people were so articulate that it paved the way for many Union soldiers to say, hey, I've talked with these people. I know what they're going through, or have some idea. This is awful. It's a system that has to go, and it's going to significantly contribute to undermining the institution of slavery. If you look at, let's put it this way, who's on the side of freedom? And when I say, and I'm going to do it this way, and who's on the side of slavery? And when I say who's on the side, I mean they love it. Or they at least tolerate it and are willing to put up with it. You've got freedom, black and white. Tubman. Garrett. William Still. The white people, I'll put Underground Railroad abbreviate. Look at that. Black and white working together. It is interesting that that's who's on the other side, too. The plantation owners are obvious. They're the chief problem. But what are you going to do here with John Tubman? What are you going to do with Thomas Otwell? Making money off of the institution of slavery? Black and white are working together in some ways with black and white on the other side. At least some of the people on the black side tolerating. This is the freedom. This is the lineage to heroism, liberty in the United States that I'm very proud to be talking about. Let me make another comment here. In 1830 census, the 1830 U.S. census, we had 3,775 free blacks. We actually had more than that, but free blacks who have one particular thing in common. 3,775 free blacks who owned 12,760 slaves. The largest black slaveholder was Andrew Durnford in Louisiana, who owned 77 slaves at the time of his death. Nat Butler was in an occupation similar to Otwell's. He was a professional slave catcher. He would try to find out who was on the Underground Railroad, capture the black as they got there, and then resell the black to a white. But if the white didn't want him, he'd try to resell him somewhere else. The greed behind a lot of slavery affected both black and white, and we see them on the negative side. The hero part, we see them on the freedom side. The freedom side, black and white working together to promote the ideals of the Declaration of Independence and to undermine the institution of slavery. Undermining slavery, setting up the boundaries here for our new country, breakthrough in professional sports, that is an aspect of the race question that must be taught to balance the teaching. Black and white working together. The creative energy is tremendous. And I'm just getting to the start of it. I mean, I enjoyed rock. I was a DJ in the late 60s and 70s, you know, rock and roll. I mean, the Fifth Dimension was one of my favorite groups, black and white, Booker T and the MGs, black and white. There's just almost something like a dynamic connection. In the church movement, the charismatic movement, the Azusa Street Revival, black and white working together to build a new church. There's something almost dynamic when the two get together. It's sad when we're separate, and that has happened and is a part of our history. I'm merely saying it's dynamic when the two get together. Thank you. Yeah. Good. Hey, Andrew.
Hi. We have time for a few questions. Just come up and state your name and school before you ask your question.
Hi, my name's Lily. I go to Fauquier High School. And my question for you is, do you have any advice? Because in today's cultural environment, white people are told that they can't have an opinion, or it's kind of like shot down to discuss race relations. It's kind of uncomfortable how to handle that conversation.
Wow. I guess that's where you have to start sometimes. And I'll tell you, I don't claim to be an expert, because my idea is, if people will know the history, they won't behave like that, I don't think. But you're talking about they're not teaching the history, or they don't know the history. I think critical race theory, especially with the emphasis on what could be, they're saying whites are oppressors and blacks are victims. I don't know which, they're both bad. I don't know whether it's worse to be an oppressor or a victim. Being a victim is terrible, because if you're a victim, then you can't overcome it. That's right. Harriet Tubman, you cannot overcome that. Benjamin Banneker, you can't overcome. Jackie Robinson, you can't overcome. Yes, they can. Yes, they can. It's hard for me to address that, because I don't accept the premise of the question. See? And so I can't answer. I said, the question is an improper question, because it's anti-historic. It's not ahistorical, it's anti-historical. The question is, hey, how can we get together and do something different to advance this country together, as we have done in the past? Not rip ourselves apart, which is the end of the United States, if it persists.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Ava. I'm from St. Brendan High School.
I wanted to know if you think that critical race theory and anti-racist curriculum is kind of undermining the story that you just told us.
Is critical race theory undermining? I absolutely think that it is undermining. And the sad thing is, and this is what sad is, that we're not getting help from the entertainment industry at all on this. Some of you may have seen the Harriet movie. Did some of you see that? Do you see some problems with the Harriet movie? And I mean, I thought I have to watch it to be able to say I've seen it. But I wanted to turn it off numerous times with its historical inaccuracies. I think critical race theory is a disaster, and I think when the entertainment industry runs programs that you might think, well, good, what we need is a story of Harriet Tubman. They did have Thomas Garrett in for a brief cameo appearance. But essentially, it was Harriet doing it herself. And it was black versus white. They treated it as black versus white. There are aspects of slavery that obviously are black versus white, although here again, I don't know what you do with Andrew Durnford and his 77 slaves, who's black. I don't know quite how you crank that in. 2% of all free blacks own some slaves. And in the South, roughly a quarter to a third of whites owned slaves. So, I mean, the whites were much more involved with it. But it is black and white working together and black and white on the other side. And I think critical race theory is not only flawed, it is contrary to what happened in history. I'm a historian. It's contrary to what happened in history. I can't deal with it other than say it's wrong.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi there. My name is Jacob Forbes. I'm one of the interns here as well. So you touched on critical race theory a little bit in your speech there. What do you think we as conservatives can do? We believe in, you know, small government and making sure that, you know,
right,
we're not too involved in our educational system. So do you think conservatives advocating for kind of banning critical race theory type education is, you know, overreaching our boundaries in any way?
That's a good question. See, it's a question of tactics. See, these are questions, okay, this group is wrong. What are our tactics? Now, I want to say once you turn the question away from history, but that's where I come in. I want to talk about history. But you turn it to tactics. I honestly believe some of you would have better ideas than I would. This is where you need the creative mind to come in here and work out ways. The idea of banning critical race theory, I don't think is the best solution, although whenever I see that a state has done it, I kind of am happy. But I don't, because it suggests that they have truth, we don't, and we're banning truth. You know, they can't bear to hear the truth, so they ban it. See, my point is, how do you get in a position where the historical record has been so distorted that that would even have credibility? You notice it didn't come in until recently. The thing is, my generation, none of this stuff was coming, which is why I'm not maybe the best person to ask tactical questions. My generation was when the integration happened. I attended a school called Center College, and I was there with the first black class that was admitted. I was so proud of that. And when they would stand up to things, I would be so impressed with my colleagues. They had one time where there was a black girl on the debate team. I was on the debate team. She was a better debater than I was. She was older. And I looked to her for inspiration. We all went to a debate tournament, and we're in a restaurant in Louisville, Kentucky. And we're going in, and the guy in charge, there was a guy out front who was giving a rose to all the women who came in. And then she walked by, and he wouldn't give her a rose. See, and then they all go over. And I remember sitting there, I was all upset. But, you know, again, it's a tactic. I'm against it. And I thought, what do I do? Well, one of the guys went back up there, this is a minute later or so, and said, excuse me, may I have one of those? And he gave him one, and then he came right back and gave that to her. And I remember thinking, that was the solution. No, he did it. That's the solution. With critical race theory, we need tactical solutions. There's some people who have been connected with YAF. Remember the one where they say, identify your pronouns, his or her? Mm-hmm. You have to identify? You remember Grant Strobel, University of Michigan? Yeah, what did he do?
His pronouns were His Majesty.
His pronouns were His Majesty. Well, it just threw the University of Michigan into a turmoil. I'm not saying, but there are tactics against critical race theory that can be used. But this is where, listen, at lunch we were talking, some of us, and you say, you talk about opportunity. Lily, say, this is your, will you say what you did?
Yeah.
Lily, I thought that was wonderful. I need it. I didn't have the opportunity because we were just integrating when I was going through. And I was sitting there, wow, you know, I was interested in music. We got rock. Diana Ross and the Supremes were a great group. And Diana Ross once said, yeah, with 80% of my record buyers being white, I like to appeal to both groups. Black and white, we're starting to work real well. Not perfect, I don't mean that. But I mean, we were entering an era. My problem was simply, hey, we're winning the integrationists. How do we handle winning? You know, I needed to remember the flower. Okay, I'll try to remember to do it. You know what I mean? We've got some people are holding back. That's their right to do that. That was the right of that guy in the restaurant to do that. And it was also very proper of my colleague on the debate team to go back and get her the flower. And so, you know, we just have to come up with the tactics. This is a time for greatness. The other side does not have the facts. And this is just one part of it. We could go even more. The great black inventors. I mean, George Washington Carver. But Elijah McCoy inventing an engine for lubricating engines for locomotives to allow them to go longer without having to stop and because the engine would overheat. We have tremendous the window screens on locomotives invented by another black person. We have great in history of invention of black and white working together. John D. Rockefeller believed. He's the first billionaire in U.S. history. Black and white need to work together. Boom. And so he says, okay, we need a college for black women. He said, the smartest thing I ever did was make Jesus Christ my Savior. The second smartest thing I did was make Laura Spellman my wife, and I'm setting up Spellman College in her honor in Atlanta for black women. Right? Whew. Henry Ford, that's the first billionaire in U.S. history. Henry Ford, the second billionaire in U.S. history. I'm going to get blacks and whites working together in my factory, and I'm going to get handicapped people, because handicapped people can screw parts in even when they're sitting down and stuff. And he would, if people would, you know, I work for food, I mean, he'd stop the car and bring them into his factory. That was a guy who reached out. It's interesting that the first two billionaires in U.S. history were attuned to the black and white working together theme. I think there's something almost spiritual about it, that it's just something, the dynamics of that are very, very special. I think it's fine to teach the negative part. They both belong together. Bring some of this in too. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
My name is Charlie Jones, and I'm one of the interns with YAF this summer. Sure. I was just wondering if you had, going back to your earlier speech, if you had any books besides your own on history of entrepreneurship that you would recommend.
Well, one book I'd like to really recommend as far as a textbook. This is important, too, because this is a textbook that he's a business historian, and he has loads of books on economics listed to touch base. Some of you may have read it. Have any of you read Larry Schweikart's Patriots History of the United States? A couple? Did you like it? Ah! I guess, you know, reading assignments always provoke. Well, I don't know if I like that. That's okay, but I think it's a great textbook. It's the only one I can just wholeheartedly recommend. Larry Schweikart, Patriots History. Look inside his chapters on business and economic growth. Tremendous offering of sources. He's an expert on that.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right, we have time for a quick 5-minute break in between. So I'll give Burt Folsom another hand, too.
Oh, thanks. Good audience.